Hi, I'm Kevin Hogan, Director of Auction Services here at Rock Island Auction Company. And I'm here today with my friend, noted firearms expert, Richard Ellis. We're back for another edition of our September lot videos for our upcoming September 11th, 12th, and 13th Premiere Firearms Auction. And you know, Richard, each auction kind of develops its own identity as we work 3, 4, 5 months procuring the firearms. As we talked about, one of the really interesting points about this sale is it covers 5 centuries of firearms design. You know, from the earliest matchlocks and wheel locks up into, you know, some of the stuff that we'll be talking about here today. You know, over the years too, we've developed such a market for US, German military, really our bread and butter. We do it better than anybody else. We've done these videos before. This is a phenomenal grouping before us. What I'm hoping we can do real quickly is talk about, one, the significance of the Shattuck Collection. You know, we sold part one earlier this year. We have part two in front of us, but you know, you've been doing this for 40 years. I don't want to date you. But you know, what is the significance of Ralph's stuff, the significance of it hitting the marketplace? And you know, let's just dive in and talk about this stuff.
Well, one thing about Ralph Shattuck was a personal friend of mine, and one thing that I always recall about Ralph is he was focused on one item, Lugers. And why he was so successful with them in many levels is the fact that he personally collected these items. So what we're fortunate enough to have here is that it's like the gift that keeps on giving. We have Ralph Shattuck's personal collection. He's long since passed, and we've been fortunate to acquire that collection. Now I guess this is part two, but every auction, you know, we keep adding. I mean, I'm looking before me is quite an array of some of his key items. I mean, these are items that in many cases, I mean, this 1900 that's right before me, it was presented, it's the first one that basically is serial number 2001, 1900. And the Swiss got the first 2,000 guns. So you take the 2,000 guns out of it, the very first gun out of the chute that would have come to America is this, but they used it as, same way, remember how Sam Colt would present guns to gain influence with governments. This was presented to a gentleman named Theodore Bingham, who had some influence in D.C., he was a groundskeeper, but he must have had some political influence for Luger to have had his associate, Hans Tascher, who was the American agent, set in place to market the Luger pistol. This particular item is brand new. I mean, he must have held it in a place of honor instead of loading it up and taking it to the range like right. He could have. You have the gold inlaid monogram in the chamber. It's serial number 2001, as I stated. If you look at the grips, you know, there's no oil staining, there's no any wear to it other than functioning wear. And it's in this beautiful original presentation case with his name inscribed on the lid. So when they presented it to him, they would have done it in such a manner. A lot of times presentations were made in this fashion so the recipient could actually read his name, which he was excited before he opened up. It was like opening a Christmas present to see that Luger inside the case with the two extra magazines and all the pertinent items you would need for that. It's one of my favorites within Ralph's collection. He valued it highly. I remember looking at his collection many years ago. You dated me with saying 40 years. It's in excess of 40 years. But along the same lines, and that same, when I mentioned the Swiss Lugers, the one right below it is actually an 1899 1900 test Luger pistol. If you'd like to pick that up and show, rather than being serialized in the front, it lacked the DWM monogram, and it was numbered on the back. As I recall, what serial number? It's 33.
Correct.
So that's a very significant historical pistol.
And again, condition.
Condition, and it was tested. See, it doesn't have that last level of brightness like a gun that was preserved in this case. It actually was exposed to the elements, and it still maintained its collection. Going along with historical, we're almost chronologic. We'll jump ahead to the Hiram Maxim presentation, 1902 carbine.
And now we've had, you know, we talked about the presentation here, and we've had, I think, a presentation of Borchard Here we go again, right?
Yeah, it's an icon. It's his initials inlaid in English for Hiram Maxim, who was a prolific gun designer, machine guns, silencers, you name it. The back of the toggle has George Luger's personal monogram, which is...
Also in gold.
Yeah, which is only placed on presentation prototype-type weapons. It's a spectacular condition, yeah. And it's an icon. It was written up in many articles, and Ralph was always very prolific about getting his message out about his collection and talk about Luger's.
And these are the keystones of that collection, very much so.
Oh, it's part of the keystone, but these, I would say, right up. In the first auction, we sold some of them, but I think we're the second auction, we're delving into the honey hole, as a friend of mine would say. Along the same line of his history, we have George Luger's personal carry gun. Basically.
And we get to see a lot of cool stuff. When you say something like that, I mean, that's significant.
Yeah, and what he did, again, we have that GL monogram on the back. He's making it for himself, basically. But it's a shortened grip. They sectioned and made it a 7-shot to make it more concealable. They actually tapered the frame rails down slightly and then made this miniaturized barrel. And it made quite a... You know, it was easy to slip in a pocket if nothing else.
Sure.
It was a concealed weapon, but that was his gun. You know, there's indisputable facts of that. Another Luger expert named Fred Dadig confirmed that with one of Luger's chief production man, August Weiss, back in the 1950s. Along the same lines, we'll move into what made Luger famous, his contracts. Remember I stated about him coming to America to solicit the Americans to buy guns. One of the other countries is right there, is a Russian contract, which has the crossed pair of Russian Moisan Nagant rifles. It was a contract of 1,000 pistols he did secure in 1906. But look at the condition. This is the, you know, we've had one other of that ilk, but I personally think it's a toss-up. This and one other we had years ago would be the finest, but past that, if you're fortunate enough to find a good Russian,
fortunate enough to even find one,
it looks like a frying pan.
Sure,
because they were used.
Sure.
In fact, I recall one years ago that was liberated in Vietnam. It was still being carried by a North Vietnamese officer. That's along lines. That's 1906. Moving up into the 30s. When Mauser took over, even though it still has the DWM toggle, this was a Turkish contract, which is extremely rare. There was only a few of these made, and that was in the 1930s. Had kind of a unique finish. They had the mark for Cal 9mm on the barrel to distinguish, because they were also selling 30 caliber commercial Lugers. This is one of, well, at the time when this was in Luger's at Random in 1969 in Ralph's collection, and they noted this, they only knew of two examples at that point. Extremely rare, high condition. Here we go, condition.
One of two.
Since we're on the Luger phase, I think, and we've had plenty of World War II Mauser Lugers, which they made a lot of them. The iconic Luger of World War II for manufacture is Krieghoff. And what we have is two very significant Krieghoff Lugers that came, again, out of Ralph Shattuck's collection. The first, if you'd like to pick up, is the 1937 Krieghoff. The original contract that the Luftwaffe had with the Krieghoff factories was for 10,000 guns. Guess what number this one is? 10,000. So it was what I call a milestone Krieghoff Luger. And what they had was, this one was their milestone. They said, okay, here's 10,000. But they actually made a few past that to make up for guns that failed inspection. And we actually, within this collection, have a 1938 Krieghoff number 10,012, one of the replacement pistols for first contract.
Very cool.
So they must have renewed the contract, so rather than bore you with all these, a Krieghoff Luger in and of itself is an extremely rare gun. When you think there was millions of Mauser Lugers produced, there was only a little over 13,000 Krieghoffs made. The most iconic Krieg off to find. That's always, when I was younger, I was always looking for one, a 1945 dated Krieg off. Now, imagine what was happening to Germany in 1945. You had the Russians coming from one end. We had, after the D-Day invasion in June 6th of 1944, we went up through France, and through the winter, we're crossing the Rhine into Germany. And they're still making Lugers. Imagine
right.
that.
Right.
After all the bombings, B-17s, Havilland bombers from the English, they could still produce a Luger. Now we're talking about Nazi Germany. Is there any you would like to talk
well,
about?
Well, I mean, the elephant in the room is obviously right before us. We've been, you know, privileged enough to handle a few of the, you know, really significant presentation Walthers. And this is one that essentially what we call got kicked out of the brush. One gun consignment from the family of the gentleman who originally liberated the gun. In terms of, you know, freshness, historical significance, it doesn't really get much better than that, does it?
Well, it's like a treasure hunt. You know, as when I'm reviewing these guns, one of my other duties for your company is the fact that when they have these inquiries for these appraisals, every once in a while something like that, a picture will get pushed across my desk, and I say, where is that one? And as I recall, the gentleman that had it was a son of a, you're correct in that, is a son of a soldier in World War II that went up through Italy. It actually was found in a SS office in Italy.
Yeah, he was in the 88th Infantry, the Fighting Blue Devils. They were the first to liberate Rome. And, you know, we got to sit down with this gentleman. You know, it's funny because we go to gun shows and you start talking to people and they say, oh, you have the greatest job in the world. Sometimes we have the greatest job in the world. You know, every work becomes work at a certain point, but these are the days that make it incredible.
Makes it worthwhile.
Well, yeah, I mean, talking to the son of a, you know, an American hero, and he has this sitting in a shoebox.
Well, yeah, and the interesting thing when they knew who they were making it for, they being Walther, any of these high presentation guns would be, you know, neat in and of themselves if they just had engraving. This has very deep chisel relief engraving. Obviously the gold wash finish, which you can see is very fragile, but this one maintains a high percentage of it. That's really excellent compared to most.
Yeah, it might be deceiving even to the camera, but
there's a lot of gold.
It's so relief that's where you're getting the depth and the darkness from.
Obviously it's never been touched. Nobody's ever messed with a gun. The interesting thing, there's a gentleman there that, well, I shouldn't use that term. There's a individual that caused a lot of grief in humanity. It was a gentleman named Heinrich Himmler. And his name is affixed with the SS runes. And it was a presentation from him where they would keep that Nazi ideology alive as they did a lot of pomp and circumstance and present to high-ranking other Germans, Nazis. You would also have that the symbol on the other grip.
This gun's, it's got a lot of documentation with it, letters of affidavit. Again, it's fresh, you know, an opportunity for a collector to essentially make it his own piece. Consecutively serial numbered to Carl Wolff's gun, I think being held right now at the West Point Museum. Unbelievably significant.
Well, you know what the difference between that and the one in West Point is? You can own this one. It's for sale.
I thought you had a great factoid or something for me.
Well, that's a pretty good factoid.
Yeah.
You can own history.
That's
it's a museum piece.
That's it.
It's exactly a museum piece.
That's it.
Along the same line, late war. I mean, I'm sure you recall selling the last one of these.
Correct.
So tell us about that, Kevin.
Well, the experience of selling it or the gun? It was phenomenal. You know, we knew we had the gun, the FG-42, that it was going to be special. It was going to be a special sale. I think we got $299,000 for it. I would have liked to get, you know, $1,000 more bucks for it. We could have said $300. But, you know, who are we to complain? They're phenomenally rare, and we're extremely excited to have another one.
Well, what that breeds is the fact that in our auction, we bring the customers to the table. Henceforth, you always have to watch subsequent auctions because we get more.
Right.
You know, that doesn't mean that, you know, I just don't want to scare everybody away here. You have a chance to buy this for much less.
Sure.
You know, but you also have an underbidder that bid the other one up.
Sure.
That you might have to contend with.
Sure. The difference, obviously, the other one had a few more accessories, but I mean, who are we to complain?
The condition, yeah, this is phenomenal. Okay, Luftwaffe drillings, we've sold numerous ones. Again, the first time we had a Luftwaffe drilling, it brought more money than people realize. I think we've seen every Luftwaffe drilling that came out of a closet, that came out of for years, but nonetheless, it's spectacular. The condition level of
one of the finer ones we've sold, based purely on condition. It does have the case and the accessories.
Now I'm not even going to quiz you on that one. I know that one is a little beyond. I pulled it out as another representation of the quality and uniqueness of a lot of our guns that we get through this auction. This particular weapon is a G41M, and where it differs from the other G41, the subsequent made G41 rifles that were made by Walther, this one is a Mauser produced one that was a combination bolt action to retract the bolt semi-automatic. And it had this very complicated gas piston system on the end of the barrel, which had a tendency to end up plugging up, and what they did is the Germans, as they evolved, they corrected that. But henceforth, it made these specimens, of which there was approximately 10,000, which is not many guns. A lot of these went to the Eastern Front, went into Russia. They're gone. And we probably have had as many, we've had five times more Luftwaffe drillings than we've had specimens of those G41Ms come through the auction. Now, along the same line, we'll get completely to the other end of the table. The most common item on this table is this K43 sniper. But what I would like to point out with this particular weapon is the condition. What we find with a lot of we've had numerous K43. You sat on the podium, you sold them. But what you don't find is, everybody always thought the way in which these were made, it looks like a piece of laminated tin, which it is, laminated wood, but GIs that brought them back could not help themselves. They always had to sand and refinish the stock because they always figured it was a piece of timber that was unfinished. And what this one excels in condition is the fact that it's just untouched. So what we like to show, because we realize that not all of our customers can afford FG-42s, and there's probably 100 times more buyers for this weapon. So we have to show the broad spectrum of what we have to offer at this auction. And that's a very fine specimen, of which we have more similar rifles, but this was one of the finer ones in the auction.
Sure. Ladies and gentlemen, German military is just the beginning for this spectacular sale. Whether it's Colts, Winchesters, wheel locks, or sporting arms, this sale has something for you. So remember, September 10th, preview day, open to the public. We have a great barbecue September 10th in the evening. We call it a social preview. Cold beer, live music, great food, and even better company. September 11th, 12th, and 13th, Rock Island Auction's premier sale. For more information, visit our website, www.rockislandauction.com. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. See you in September.